I couldn't, truly couldn't imagine a more interesting and better guest than Galen Buckwalter. Galen was the inventor of the matching algorithm at eHarmony, the dating site, which was the very first dating site in the world using an algorithm to match people. He's today the chief science officer at psyML, and we'll talk a whole bunch about psyML today, where he's using psychological assessments to bring machine learning and robotics into the human realm. Galen, I'm so stoked to have you here.
Pleasure.
You've spent like literally your whole career on like trying to figure out like how people tick, right? And you've done this at eHarmony, and we'll talk a little bit about the dating space a little later. But what are, there's this concept of psychometrics,
right,
which is really like your life's work, right?
Absolutely.
Like, what are psychometrics, and how do we use them in a technology sense?
Yeah, psychometrics literally is the process of applying numbers to human behaviors. So when we know that as people we have traits like intelligence, like openness, like we have emotions, all of these exist, but if we want to study them, we have to be able to measure them. The process of quantifying these latent traits is a very kind of arduous and systematic process. But basically it boils down to you hypothesize something that exists, then you collect evidence of how it exists with internally with the measurements, the items that you're using, and then how it relates to other constructs that you hypothesize. So ultimately you get to a position where, you know, you say it looks like a duck, it quacks like a duck, you know, you have anger, have openness, or some personality trait. So that's the process of psychometrics. Applying it online has, to me, always seemed like a gift to psychologists, because online, you know, we're able to, for the first time, apply psychometrics at scale. The biggest problem in academic research around human traits has been simply that, you know, you look at studies of even 20 years ago, you were surprised if you saw an N of 200 subjects. And that probably took the poor dissertation student, you know, a couple of years to collect. But now, with the internet, with crowdsourcing sites like Mechanical Turk, we're able to get thousands of people to take questionnaires overnight, which has sped up the pace of personality and emotion research just exponentially. So it's really exciting time to.
Interesting. Let me ask you a question. Like, so when we measure, particularly a concept like personality, in your view, and I think this is the age-old question, is like, how much of personality is stuck? Is like, you know, it is who we are, and it will pretty much always be who we are.
Right.
And how much of it is a fluid concept which changes pretty dynamically in terms of like, you know, my evolution as a being.
Yeah. I mean, it's a great question, and it's one we're still figuring out. There are clearly dimensions that change minimally across the lifespan, but there's always change, you know, particularly around periods of great kind of relationship and social change. So, you know, we see major personality shifts like around the time when when young people go to college, you know, a great increase in openness, and, you know, kind of exploration behaviors. You also see changes around the time that people get into long-term relationships. So you probably see a common theme there that personality changes most in response to relationships, which tells you a lot about our brain, I think.
Yeah.
You know, that you know, our brain, our personality, I think, you know, it forms, you know, fairly early on, by, you know, 7 or 8. It also forms around 6 dimensions that we've only recently really nailed down.
That's the hexaco model.
That's
right?
The hexaco model.
Can you explain this a little bit?
Sure. You know, over the generations, there's been, you know, psychologists have always, you know, had theories about personality. You know, Freud had the theory of, you know, subconscious and the unconscious. You know, Jung had the archetypes. And then there was also a very empirical aspect of psychology that looked at personality in using advanced analytics, primarily factor analysis. Interestingly, in the late 80s, early 90s, both of those converged into what was initially called the ocean model or the five factor model, which was openness, conscientiousness, extroversion, agreeableness, and neuroticism. In really the past 5 to 10 years, a sixth dimension has been added, honesty. And additionally, you know, we've shifted from using the somewhat pejorative term neuroticism to calling that dimension emotionality.
Gotcha.
So now we have these 6 dimensions, which really, for the first time, give us a rock-solid understanding of personality. I mean, this exists everywhere. Huh. Every culture, you know, both genders. It's really solid. It gives us something to start to look at, you know, how much we change over the course of lifespan. Again, you know, we see subtle movements in these, but by and large, you know, the general structure of our personality stays the same. So, you know, in terms of online applications, that's where at psyML we're really excited to not just measure people for academic, you know, research purposes, but to use that in applied settings. You know, my partner, Dave Herman, and I had worked at a financial services company called Payoff before we started psyML. And there, you know, we were able to understand how much credit risk was related to personality.
Wow.
Factors that you can just use the hexaco. And
it's also a little scary, right?
In
the shoes of like the, yeah, applying for credit, for example.
If handled in the wrong way, I think it could be.
Yeah.
Our approach is that we only use it in the context of self-insight. So we're not going to be using this in a way that people don't understand. And we also think that in the context of self-insight, people are able to then start taking control of their personality. They understand it. They can better understand why they have problems with credit. And then they can, you know, work kind of in conjunction with their personality to do what it takes for them. That's a very critical point about applying this research is, you know, for PsyML, we envision our AI to ultimately be empathy engines. That, you know, we know a lot of, you know, what's good about humanity. We know that gratitude is hugely powerful and hugely beneficial to our very brain. So if we can start using, you know, this information and helping using machines to help us understand and advance our own empathy abilities, our own ability to be grateful, that's when it seems like it's a very positive thing.
Yeah. And you're applying this also to robotics, right? The plan is to like make robots more human?
Very much. You know, we think like right now, you know, we're using it to, you know, just to, one instance that we're using this technology is with people who have abused drugs and are trying to stay off of them.
Yeah.
So we have a bot that our brilliant developers, Grace G and Eugene Wang, shout out, that they have developed these AI systems that are capable of interacting with people that are experiencing, you know, desires to use drugs in a very empathetic, understanding way. They, in addition to understanding personality, we're putting a lot of effort into understanding emotion, which is our short-term mood state.
Yeah.
So, you know, no matter what our personality is, you know, if something really bad happens, we're going to be sad or we're going to be angry. And that's going to influence everyone, how they react. So we want to be able to understand someone's long-term, you know, characteristics, their personality. But then we react in the moment also based on their emotions. So, you know, drug abuse prevention program, we check in every morning with the people to get a read on, you know, whether they're feeling angry or happy, what their energy level is, because sometimes with drug abuse, if you're feeling really high and good, that's a risk. So based on all that information, then we react, you know, we give people exercises to do, basic cognitive behavioral therapy approaches. But throughout all of this, the machines learn. So we think, you know, that given the machine this understanding of us, this understanding of people as growing through self-understanding, through empathy towards others, that puts a very different light on AI.
Yeah,
you know, I don't think, you know, if Elon Musk was thinking about AI in this context, would he be afraid of it?
Right. Well, I also can totally see the applications if we're thinking about particular machines in the form of physical machines, robots becoming much more embedded in our lives, mm-hmm. we want them to be, likely we want them, not all of them, right? Like yeah. the cooking robot doesn't need to be empathetic, I guess.
Right.
Probably he needs to, because if I feel down, he should cook me, or you know, it should cook yeah. me comfort food, yeah. right?
Right.
But I can totally see the implication. I'm really excited about your work. Before I have my last question for you for this interview, where can people learn more about your work, psyML? How can they probably get involved?
Yeah, our site is at psyml.co. We're developing that quite rapidly now, so you'll start to see that. I have a Medium page at Galen Buckwalter. You can look up what we're writing there.
Okay, so psyml.co, and then check out Medium. My very last question, and I'm sorry we have to go there, because you brought the world eHarmony. With online dating has gone through so many iterations, right? We had eHarmony, and then we had Match, and then we had like Plenty of Fish, and now we've got Tinder. And do you think it's today the way to actually find your spouse? And like, full disclosure, I found my spouse the old way, and I'm very, very happily married to like the most amazing woman on the planet. But do you think, like, on average, like the machines are better to find our perfect match than the old-fashioned way?
Yeah, well, there is some data starting to show up. There was a large-scale study published in the Proceedings of the National Academy of Science just about 2 years ago, I think, that looked at eHarmony, they looked at Match, they looked at your method of dating in the wild, as we call it. But what they found was that eHarmony, the divorce rate, was significantly lower than Match, but Match was also significantly lower than the wild. So it seems like, you know, just the process of looking at your potential partners in a more, you know, kind of systematic way. I mean, marriage is not, marriage requires the passion and the, kind of the chemistry.
Yeah.
But if you rely on that, that is not a good start for marriage. And I think I think in the wild, that's a temptation. I think there can be advantages to a more systematic exploration that online dating kind of enhances.
Okay, now I have to ask you a very last cheeky question.
Yeah.
Where did you meet your wife?
The old-fashioned way, in a class I was teaching.
Fantastic, I love it. So all of you guys, get out there, find your match. If you don't find your match out there, use apps, and definitely, definitely keep an eye on psyML and Galen's incredible work. I truly believe your work will influence and change the way we think about machines interacting with us, making them truly more human.